Hello and thanks for joining us again on the SEABL Preview Show. This week I've been joined by Rohan Short as we preview the preliminary round of matches. Rohan, thanks for joining us.
Thanks for having me, Ed, and I am excited about the finals and the preliminary matches. The fact that teams got to 16 and 12 wasn't enough, and a five-way split for finals positions is just outstanding for the SEABL in terms of how even this competition is, and this weekend the matches will be no different. Looking forward to it.
This week we're going to preview the two preliminary finals from each conference, and then we're also going to have a look at some of the potential award winners as we also approach the MVP and finals dinner, which we'll talk about a bit later. But first of all, just recapping on some news from this week and some results. Rohan, Nunawading look like they're back to almost their best, while you saw Knox get rolled at the State Basketball Centre.
Yeah, the Spectres caught fire in the third quarter there, shooting 52% from the field for the game. Six guys in double figures, and probably the biggest contribution there was from the young guy, Marlo Hicks, 18 and 10. If he can replicate that performance in playoff basketball, that just adds another weapon to the Nunawading roster. But I did go out and see the Knox-Albury game, and I have to say I was quite disappointed with the performance by Knox. Albury just steamrolled them from the beginning. They had no answer for Jasmar Ferguson. But really, for me, the key for Albury was the contribution of not only Nick Payne, who was sensational from go to woe, but it was all the role players that all chipped in and had a great game. Hollis, they were fantastic for the team.
Mate, we'll move on and get now straight into our previews. We'll start off with the game between Geelong and Bendigo. Bendigo have won five in a row now. They're pretty much the hottest team in the competition.
Yeah, look, Delvez has obviously stepped up for them, making massive contributions. And, you know, I'm excited about Bendigo's prospects. I think they've really started to build momentum as the finals have gone on. They're out-rebounding teams. They're out-working teams. We're getting contributions out of Probert and Randall on week after week. And that's the key for Bendigo. You know, I think they've made some significant adjustments to position themselves well for the finals. And look, for Geelong, for me, it keeps coming back to these, you know, individual contributions from guys like Wilson. He had 31 points last week, a lot of shots. Medved had to take 15 shots to stay in touch with them. These teams only played a fortnight ago, and Bendigo got the better of them by 10 points. So look, if Geelong can shoot the ball a little bit better from the foul line, I mean, they went 12 of 22 last time they played, it'll be an interesting game. But look, I think it's the effort war in this game. If Bendigo can come to work and just assert their presence on the interior with rebounding, I'm sorry to say, but I'm just not sure whether Geelong has the talent to match them.
On to our next game, and we move over to the South Conference, the game between Knox and Nunawading. Now, my question to you is this, Rohan. I think about 6 weeks ago you said there's no reason why Nunawading can't win their last seven in a row and go all the way through. And then in the last round you said you're off Nunawading, you jumped off them, they gave you no confidence. I want to know now, are you back on them or are you off them?
No, I'm definitely not necessarily back on them.
So you're sitting on the fence.
I'm definitely sitting on the fence. It all comes down to injury, doesn't it?
Yeah.
You know, when they've lost key players in key positions with Con, Cameron, you know, they've struggled.
Yeah.
I certainly wasn't happy with the way that they finished out the season. I think it was disappointing. They should be playing this one at Nunawading, not playing it at the State Basketball Centre. That's what they've given up.
Yeah.
You know, I'm just worried about their ability to play in patches. You know, they lose focus, they lose a bit of concentration throughout the course of the game, and they give teams a sniff. And when you give teams a sniff at this time of the season, it can roll you. You know, you get down by 10 or 12 early on in a game, you're in trouble. So, you know, for me, you know, I think if they continue to do what they did last week and virtually operate on Hobart in the second half, play inside out, open up their three-point shooters, shoot the ball as confidently as what they did, they'll do really well. But if they played Knox like they played him the last time, CJ Massengale had 45 points on them last time. You know, who in the Nunawading roster is competent enough to defend that position?
A prediction, mate?
Look, I'm probably going to go with Nunawading on this one, only because I think their depth and the issue with Leicester, you know, and the focus that'll be around CJ performing again, I think Nunawading should get the assignment done, and so I'm going to back them.
Mate, We're approaching the time of year where SEABL announces our award winners for the season. Now, there's a host to get through, and this year we're showcasing our awards at the SEABL MVP and finals dinner to be held at Caulfield Racecourse the night of the championship games on September 8th. Tickets are $100. They're still available. And if you look on the screen now, the details are there for how to purchase one for the night. Mate, we're going to get your tips on a few possible award winners this year. Starting off with the Coach of the Year. Now, to me, there's a couple of standouts, but, you know, I want to get your thoughts on who the best mentor this year has been.
Yeah, look, in the East, I think you obviously have to look at the best record in the competition when you're looking at the Coach of the Year competition. And DP has had a fantastic year with that squad. They stumbled a little bit towards the end, but they could have finished the season with just only six losses. So, yeah. Look, for me, DP's been a standout there, but I also like the fact that Ben Harvey made a tough call during the year with his point guard. That shows courage as a coach. But on the other side, look, for me, the Coach of the Year is Brad Chalmers. Albury Wodonga's resurgence as a club, a resurgence as a team, all the way. They've got a blueprint, they've got a model. You can see it, you can see what he's working towards. And for me, he's done an outstanding job with that squad. So look, for me, Coach of the Year is Chalmers.
Mate, we'll move on to the big one. Championship winner and MVP. Now, I think a couple of standout candidates for MVP, you'd have to look at CJ Massengale, Kamani Barrett, at Geelong, and then there's maybe a few players who don't maybe get the recognition they deserve, but the coaches might notice players like Tony Lewis and Daquan Montreal. Who have you seen that's really impressed you this year?
Look, in the East Conference, you know, I've been impressed with all three of those guys that you mentioned. Tony Lewis, Yibi, and Barrett. Yeah. You know, they're three guys that I think, not only from a points production point of view, but the overall influence that they have on their team, I think, needs to be taken into consideration. Sure. So there, for me, look, Yibi has to he has had to have a very good season for Bendigo to be the position that they're in.
Absolutely.
And Kamani Barrett, for what he did at the time that he was available with the Geelong Supercats, and I only was struck down by injury, is once again an MVP candidate, in my opinion, given the fact that Geelong have still finished the season in good shape.
In the other conference?
And in the other conference in the South, look, I like the fact that CJ, at his age and looking to get a contract in the NBL, is averaging 25-6 on the season. I mean, that's phenomenal for the role that he has to play on his team. I know Shane McDonald has had a fantastic season. If I compare it to the last season, it's probably not the same.
Yep.
But without doubt, the MVP of the league in both conferences is Jasmar Ferguson.
Over the last few weeks, I've been around and had the opportunity to speak to some of the coaches and get their tips on who they thought the MVP and championship winner might be.
MVP, that's a tough one. Everyone talks about Albury's point guard in Ferguson, but I like the big guy in the combo. I think he's been fantastic.
Kamani Barrett would have been my pick for the MVP. I don't know whether he'll still win it, but without him, I think they're going to struggle. I think Bendigo's a danger in that pool, but I still like Darren Perry, who's my Coach of the Year, and Dandenong.
I mean, Tony Lewis is really balling on the Dandenong side, and so is his offsider. So I'm sure it's going to be probably coming out of the Dandenong camp.
I think it's Dandenong and probably Knox in the championship game. A lot of experience, a lot of youth. It's so hard to pick a winner, but I'll go with Dandenong just because they're on our side of the draw, and I'll give the MVP out to Daquan Montreal.
So the coach is giving there a lot of love for Dandenong, I think, Rohan.
Yeah, and what didn't Vince just play Chuck Lotto there? Just put a whole bunch of names in a hat and just goes,
pull
I'll take
out.
This one.
So the championship winner, mate, who's your tip?
Yeah, look, I've seen this team on about four occasions this year, and without doubt I'd have to agree with the coaches on this one. If you're a betting man, you're probably going to go with your Dandenongs. I think they've done everything right. They've played very consistently. They understand their system. They've got a little bit of depth going on in their squad, and they've got two fantastic imports that are rock steady. And I was just so pleased to see Harmsy have a fantastic final last week. Gives me great confidence to see him playing in form, because I think if Nutter Wadding or Knox get through in that that other conference, you know, that matchup there is exciting. And not only that, if it's with Jasmo, I think Harmsey will play a big role in a couple of weeks' time.
Well, mate, that pretty much does it for us for this week. But before we wrap it up, indeed, the SEABL community and the whole basketball community in Australia was saddened by the news this week of the passing of two Toowoomba Mountaineers players, Stacey Richter and Stephanie Milanos. It's a tragic turn of events, Rohan.
Yeah, look, I've spent some time watching the QABL in my time in Townsville, and I know the Toowoomba community is very passionate about their basketball, and this will be a tragic loss for them in particular. And look, I know that everyone up there in Queensland, but just wanted to know that down here in the SEABL, we're thinking of them too, because our athletes get in their cars every weekend as well and go to various venues, and you know, it's something that we never want to see. But it is a timely reminder for all of us to take care and on our roads, and our thoughts do go out to the family and the QABL in particular.
Yeah, thoughts are with you and the SEABL passes on their condolences. But Rohan, thanks for joining us again this week. We hope to have you on one more time before the end of the season.
Well, it's you know, let's hope so, and let's get excited for what should be a great SEABL MVP dinner. And I want every player to be there. And
you're going to be there, aren't you?
I'm definitely going to be there. I'll be there for sure. It's a free meal. That's why I come on the show. I get a free meal. So, yeah, looking forward to it.
All right, mate. Thanks again. Remember, you can always get the latest SEABL headlines by following us on Facebook or on Twitter. But until next week, it's bye for now.